here with DeBrae Kennedy-Mayo. Welcome.
Hello, how are you?
I'm great. How are you so far?
It's been a wonderful conference.
That's good to hear. Can you tell me a bit about your academic journey?
I probably have a longer academic journey than some, but by training, I'm an attorney. I graduated from
Really?
Neurotechnology University in the United States.
Okay.
And after having a career as an attorney for about 10 years, I moved into the academic world. I'm a faculty member at Georgia Tech.
Okay. And what do you do for university there?
So primarily, I do research. Mm-hmm. So at the intersection of privacy and cybersecurity and law and policy. So we try to be that interplay and try and figure out, do we need a tech solution to something? Do we need a policy solution? Or do we just need people to talk?
Okay, which brings us to your paper.
It does.
Because you just presented one. Can you tell us a bit about it?
So I have a co-author, Jake Gore, and he and I work together at Georgia Tech.
Yeah.
And we do a lot, again, in the privacy space, but we really realize that for models, so AI models, mm-hmm. that there was something that currently existed called a model card that was some transparency,
mm-hmm.
but it didn't include some of the things that today we would talk about. Today we would talk about risk environment and risk management and trustworthiness. And so we've incorporated these ideas. And what we've hoped to do is to change a model card from something that was just outward facing and obviously oftentimes B2B to something that was internally facing. So everybody in the company would be thinking about ethical issues from a practical standpoint and trying to help answer the questions of trustworthiness and risk management.
Why is that important?
I think today, even in this conference, we've heard people say, hey, I'm doing research related to emotional AI and how we can capture the information, but I'm a technical person. Ethical people, our legal compliance people deal with those issues. And it's like, let's
not
think
the right way
though.
To do that. Yeah.
Well, it's the way that we're classically trained of this person has this job and I have this job. But in reality, particularly when we're talking about impactful AI, we want everyone to be involved because we want the conversation not to be a conversation of what the person on the legal team thinks the answer should be, but what everybody in the company thinks the answer should be. Because these are really things that are going to affect society as a whole. And so we want to make sure that we have the best products that we can coming out.
That makes sense to me. Is there anything interesting that came up while you were doing your research?
I think some of the challenges that we were seeing, we saw ways to actually explain them best by talking about some things that came up at this conference, which are neurotechnologies.
Okay.
That in the future, you're going to probably have a chip in your brain. And who's going to have access to that? Is a business going to have access to that? Is a government going to have access to that? We want the people who are designing today to be thinking all the way through that chain. Where is this going to end up? Do we put in place some privacy by design, some security by design today to make sure that we don't wind up with an unintended consequence in the future?
Okay, but we're not there yet. How long do you think it will take before
we're on the edge of it already.
Okay. Yeah.
So we've already have earbuds that you can put in that can do an EEG, basically a little bit of a, you know, listening to your brain and then tell you basically through music what they think your mood is.
Okay.
And Neuralink, which is a US-based company, already for people who have very significant health issues, so say they've lost mobility, they already have some implants that they can do that will say allow somebody who's paralyzed to be able to actually like play a video game.
Okay.
They play it with their mind.
Yeah.
And so you can imagine that the first place that we're gonna see that kind of implant is likely in people who play video games, because you won't have to use a controller. There won't be that delay that we have today.
Awesome. Okay, how has the conference been for you so far?
It's been great. I love to interact with people from around the world to hear different views on issues like privacy and cybersecurity. Is it working? Is it not working? Where do we want to go with AI?
Yeah.
And so that's what we're doing here.
Okay. Did you get to go on the boat trip by any chance?
I did.
How was it?
It was beautiful. We had a beautiful weather, but also the history that is Berlin. So East and West that have come together. We literally went on a boat tour that went across that line. And at one time it had been a very sad place, and today it's a beautiful place with lots of people sitting outside and enjoying the weather. And it's nice to see that we have these democratic principles that are in play today.
Thankfully.
And that line has been gone for a long time.
Okay. I will finish with some rapid fire questions.
Do my best.
First off, what's an important skill for a researcher to have?
Being concerned about the impacts of their research.
Okay. Which industry will be most transformed by AI in the upcoming 5 years?
I don't know the answer to that. I think that we could see potentially across the board.
Yeah.
Or we could see a lot less than we expect today, but I think that humans will be involved, particularly in the next 5 years, in any transformation that happens. So we'll have human in the loop.
Well, that brings me to the next question. Artificial intelligence or human intelligence?
And I see that it's going to become a both.
Yeah.
I do think that that's important, and I think it's going to be exciting.
Okay. Do you think AI consciousness will be possible?
You make an assumption that it's not already there.
Okay.
And so I think it is not the consciousness that you and I experience, but we already have AI that can hallucinate,
yeah,
which actually means that it can lie, and we already have AI that can scheme.
Mm-hmm.
So we have some very early stages of consciousness. It's not, I don't think it'll ever be like our consciousness.
Okay. But just different.
Different, yes.
Okay. What's a big research motivation for you?
Make the world a better place.
Is there a book or a resource you'd recommend for people interested in your field?
One that comes to mind is The Battle for Your Brain, mm-hmm. which is by Anita Farahany. And
yeah.
she is a researcher in the United States that's really trying to make sure there are neuro rights in place. And it's one of the things that's important. We also need to make sure there are technical approaches. But it's one of the things that's looking at, once we get the brain data, how do we protect it? Because
yeah.
it's going to be the most intimate type of data that we've ever had.
Okay. Is there some advice you ever received as a researcher which would be good to share?
Advice as a researcher, make sure that you include more than just your own viewpoint.
Okay, DeBrae, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you
and
so
enjoy
much.
The rest of the conference.
Thank you so much.